Well, thank you for that. I was wondering if we were going to mention my other two congregations as well. Raleigh and Hickory would have been slighted. So, greetings to all of you. Happy Sabbath to all of you. Wow, I am really up high. Hi down there. Yeah, it's always different to come to a different church area and speak. It's not like back home, but the people are like back home. That's what's really nice. So, we have about 50 in each of our congregations. On a good day, Hickory might be a little bit larger of the three congregations, but we are happy to have them. And they webcast also, and they're webcasting at the same time we are. There, of course, an hour time difference, so we're wondering how come you're not watching the Greensboro webcast. Why are you watching this one? So anyway, I've known Mr. Servideo for quite some time. I think it goes back to 1972. I believe that was the year, 72, 73. Were you student body president that year? And that was my freshman year at Big Sandy, so we go back a long ways, but it's been some time since I've been able to spend much time with him. We see each other at the conference and so on, but that's about it. So, all right. Well, I think you have several visitors here today for one particular reason. How many are here for the Casey Harper wedding? You know, there are several, a lot of them back there. So, so are we. That's why we're here. So, appreciate being asked to be able to give the sermon to you. I wondered what I might speak about, and I got to thinking, well, we're close to Pentecost time. Maybe I should speak something about Pentecost. So that's what we're going to do, because Pentecost is coming fast. It's only about 3 weeks away now, and Pentecost is one of those that's kind of snuck in there in the middle. We pay a lot of attention to preparing for the Passover. We do our pre-Passover exam, and we're already planning for the Feast of Tabernacles. Oh, yeah, by the way, there's Pentecost. So. But it's very important. It's tucked in there in the middle, and so I think that helps us to think about two critically important aspects of God's plan of salvation as we think of that. One is that God has certainly granted us repentance, and upon our baptism and the laying on of hands, He gives us the incredible gift of His Holy Spirit. And with that Spirit, we are to develop godly character in our lives. We have our lifetimes to be able to do that, or as long as God has called us and given His Spirit. Second aspect is that God has specifically called a group of individuals first. First fruits, they're called. Prior to the time that He will call, the vast majority of mankind will be called at a later time, at a different time. And He's called us first to prepare for something. And I think that's very important, to prepare to help administer the government of Jesus Christ upon this earth during that time that He will be calling the rest of mankind. So in the sermon today, I want to focus our attention on a major aspect of point two. Remember what point two was? It was to prepare. We're going to focus on the word prepare. How are our lives as the first fruits today preparing us for something? A specific responsibility that we're going to have tomorrow as pictured by the fall holy days, as we think of the Feast of Tabernacles, and the meaning of the Feast of Tabernacles. So again, Pentecost tucked in here, and it kind of links the two. But then even more specifically, as we think about preparing for our responsibilities, what is it? What are our responsibilities as first fruits? Could our responsibility as first fruits have something to do with preparing to help second fruits? I'll coin that term. I don't know whether you've used that or not, but I like that term, the second fruits. If we have first fruits, that kind of indicates there might be more. So that's a term I want to zero in on today. We, again, talk so much about first fruits, but we don't talk so much about the second. And I believe that they should be of primary concern to us today as we are reminded, again, of the meaning of Pentecost, but also reminded, as we're in the middle, the meaning of the Feast of Tabernacles. We're preparing for the feast already. We're having announcements about the feast. Everyone's saying, where are you going for the feast? Pigeon Forge. So see y'all there. So that was a plug for Pigeon Forge. So, okay. But anyway, I do believe we are, as the first fruits of today, preparing to help the second fruits of tomorrow. They are going to need help. They will have a very important role to play themselves in the plan of God. So today, let's go on with the sermon as we learn a little bit more about the second fruits. The sermon will be entitled, The Trials of the Second Fruits. I know we like to have sermon titles, so that's the title I chose, The Trials of the Second Fruits. But before we get to them, let's review a little bit and let's establish a foundation to explain the second fruits. We, of course, believe we are the first fruits. That's a term we've used, and the Pentecost is known as the Feast of First Fruits. We get that from James 1:18 is a place where we can go to see that word first fruits. It says, of his own will he brought us forth by the word of truth that we might be a kind of first fruits of his creatures or his creation. If you are actually going to go to the dictionary and define the word first fruits, the word means the first results or products of an endeavor. The first results or products of an endeavor. So basically speaking, we are talking about God's endeavor, that's what we're looking at, or God's project. Okay, let's say then the first products of God's project, that is the plan of salvation. And we believe that's who we are. The holy days show us that God has a plan of salvation, of course, not just for us. But he's got all mankind. He loves all mankind and wants all mankind to be in his kingdom, to live forever. His will is that all mankind receives the knowledge of God, comes to repentance, receives the Holy Spirit, and receives the gift of eternal life. That's God's will. That's his plan. That's his project. That's his endeavor. Now, the holy days also reveal to us that this is a process of time. It's not happening overnight. We believe it's involving approximately 7,000 years. And while we don't set dates, we think we're kind of getting close to the end of the 6,000-year time. The time that God is working with the first fruits, at least working with them on a human level, and then he will begin a new and a different part of his plan as he works with more of mankind on into the future. And again, we're talking about the time that so many that have died are resurrected. So let's ask this, what has been God's plan then for the first fruits? Again, remember, the very term first fruits refers to a small number that comes before a larger number, the larger harvest that comes later. Now remember, John 6:44 says that we cannot even come to the knowledge of the truth unless we are called. We have to be called and chosen by God to understand his way of life and his truth. The church is called a little flock. So just a few are called to be able to be first fruits, a small amount. We are that rare seed that is scattered and actually fell on good ground, where we grew and we were nurtured and we able to grow on that in that rich soil. We're also told that, you know, because some falls away, you know, the bad soil and can't take root, and that we have an adversary in the form of Satan the devil. Satan the devil, we're told, deceives the whole world. Of course, they don't recognize that. They don't believe that they're deceived. And only a few are rescued from that deception now. Only a very few, the first fruits. And God has allowed us to be among those who over these past 6,000 years have the opportunity to be called first. What an honor, what a blessing that is. But why? Why is that? Over the last 6,000 years, what have the first fruits been asked to do that is different from everybody else? What is our responsibility that God has given us because he's called us and said, you are my first fruits. Here's what I want you to do. What is that? I think there are three basic responsibilities that God has given to us. They're not unique to us as first fruits because eventually everyone will do this. We are simply first, of course. So these are our responsibilities as first fruits now. Number one, prepare our lives now. Learn to be Christ-like. You've heard many sermons about that. Christian living sermons, they're called. Prepare to be Christ-like. It says, let this mind be in you that was in Christ Jesus. We often quote from Philippians 2, right? Let the mind of Jesus Christ be in us. Well, is it? Are we learning that? So we study the life of Christ. We respond to life situations as he would because we've studied it. And we know how he would respond. A second responsibility mentioned in the sermonette, developing all the fruits of God's Holy Spirit. Now, we could turn there, but you know what they are. Our lives must define the fruit of God's Holy Spirit, including, of course, love, joy, peace, long-suffering, goodness, and so on. That's us. That's our responsibility. We develop those characteristics in our lives. Number three, we grow in godly character and righteousness. What about holiness? I remember talking to the teens one time in a teen Bible study at the feast, and I said, you have to be holy. What do you think about that? Well, they haven't really thought of that. They didn't consider themselves holy, but that's what we're called to do, to live in holy, righteous character, to be that. 1 Peter 1:15 tells us, and again, I'm going to go fast through these scriptures, a couple of them, but it says, 1 Peter 1:15, as he who called you is holy, you also be holy in all your conduct. Well, are we doing that? It says, be holy, because it is written, be holy, for I am holy. Do you ever know that was written in the book of Leviticus? Not once, not twice, not three times. Four times you'll find that phrase in Leviticus about holiness and walking and living in holiness. Now, you might think of other responsibilities, but those are the three basic ones that we'll just leave you with right there. We need to talk about them, and we do talk about them all the time. But as we live this way of life, this Christian way of life, living through the example of Jesus Christ and developing godly character, we find, wait a minute, that's not always easy. Sometimes that's a difficult walk to walk, and there are obstacles along the way. Obstacles on our journey that we didn't think of, we didn't expect. So what trials and tests go along with our role as first fruits? We're talking about trials of second fruits. What about our trials? We have some going through some really severe trials, don't we? One particular trial I might think of that we might not see right now as much as we might see later on, but our predecessors in centuries past have seen it. What about persecution? 2 Timothy 3:12, all who desire to live godly in Christ Jesus will suffer persecution. We maybe haven't had our share yet. Maybe we will. But we're told, even though we will suffer persecution, what about 1 Peter 1 and verse 6? Talking about our trials and our severe trials. 1 Peter 1 and verse 6, we have various trials. But it says, we're to greatly rejoice, though now for a little while, if it is necessary. And those are key words. Sometimes, God knows, trials, sore trials, are necessary. If need be, you've been grieved. Sometimes we cry ourselves to sleep at night, don't we? Our various trials. God understands. He knows. Why? Verse 7, so that the genuineness of your faith, being much more precious than gold that perishes, though it is tested by fire, may be found to praise, honor, and glory at the revelation of Jesus Christ. And that's what we're looking forward to, isn't it? So we have persecution. We have various trials. What other trials do we have? I could have conversations with all of you, and you could tell me about trials, but they basically fall into various categories. What about employment problems? How many have had problems getting off for the Sabbath day or for the holy days? I know Mr. Savidio has to give the excuse letter, the form letter. You know, I need off work sometimes for the holy days. Sometimes they want to say no, or even to find a job. You're looking for a job, maybe not so much in the Houston, Texas area, because employment's pretty good. But in some places back in North Carolina, I've got a guy who's been looking for work for about a year, and every time he goes to find something, Sabbath comes up. It's a real problem. So we have problems getting off for the Sabbath and holy days. But that's just minor. What about, if we think about the church on an international level, and I'm so thankful that we are able to see the church more on an international level, thanks to the pastors that travel over to Africa and other places and do a travel blog and show us videos and pictures and stories about the brethren over there. That's really nice. And Mr. Meeker's over there now. He's traveling in Burundi, in the Congo, and other countries there in Africa. Sometimes that makes our problems seem not so big after all, compared to what we see that they have. But we have other trials. What about relationship problems with family and friends over the fact that we are members of God's church? Some have spouses that are really antagonistic about them even being in the church, or they're different COGs, and there's things like that, or there's just anger. I know one person back home where he's in a very difficult situation with his family. In fact, it's in a dangerous situation. There's so much antagonism towards him. So he has to cope with things like that, and sometimes people do. Some of us have sacrificed close family relationships because our family will disown us, have nothing to do with us for what we believe. Remember, we were told when we were counseled for baptism, when we counted the cost, right? Luke 14, we have to always put God first. Another common trial, we just heard about it, you know, Mrs. Salyer, about sickness. We have people who have been endured sicknesses for a long time, and we wonder, why doesn't God heal them? I might remind you of Mr. Cecil Moranville, who's back in our Hickory congregation. Most of you know who that is, writes the Personal Correspondence Department. Mr. Moranville has been in severe pain for a number of years. His pain level is usually up there on about an 8. That's where he lives, and sometimes it gets to be a 10. But he has a condition that where his pain is multiplied over normally what ours is. So he lives in pain all the time. So I'd ask you to continue to pray for him. So, you know, we wonder when people have situations like that, cancers and so on, why doesn't God heal? Why doesn't he heal more? We have to endure that trial. Again, sometimes we don't understand why, but sometimes God simply asks us, doesn't he? He says, trust me on this. I know what I'm doing. I'm here. I love you. Trust me. God has a reason for everything in our lives. He is very much involved in our lives. And that brings me to the next aspect of our lives as first fruits. When we think about having severe trials and difficulties like I've been describing, where do we turn? Well, actually, we don't turn. We fall down on our knees, don't we? We cry out to God for help. We ask Him for help. We don't face these difficulties alone, do we? God the Father is always there for us. I want us to go to Isaiah 41. Isaiah 41, written to the descendants of Abraham. But let's consider this as being written to not physical Israel, but spiritual Israel, the Israel of God, the church. And listen to these words. Isaiah 41, pick it up in verse 8. Isaiah 41, verse 8, but you Israel, or how could, maybe we could say, but you church member, are my servant, whom I have chosen, the descendants of Abraham, my friend, you whom I have taken from the ends of the earth and called from its farthest regions, and I've said to you, you are my servant, I have chosen you, and I have not cast you away. That's God talking to us. He's called us. We're his servant, servants of God, and he has called us from the farthest regions. So verse 10, fear not, for I am with you. Be not dismayed, for I am your God. I will strengthen you. Yes, I will help you. I will uphold you with my righteous right hand. That's comforting when you read that. We can depend on that. That God is our Father, and he's hearing that, and he knows what we're going through, and he will comfort us. God is right there with us. In fact, we're told another reference for you, 2 Corinthians 1 and verse 3, more familiar. God's the God of all comfort. And we're learning that. We're learning how to comfort others. He comforts us in our tribulation, it says, so that we might be able to comfort those others who are in trouble with the comfort with which we ourselves have been comforted with. So we're learning about comfort from God because he comforts us so that we can learn to comfort others. And we have that promise of strength, that promise of comfort from our Father. We have Jesus Christ, our intercessor, our high priest. And we can come to him because he knows what it's like and how it feels. He hears our prayers also. And he knows what it's like for us to cope with the various difficulties and the trials and the agony and the situations that we have sometimes. And sometimes they're very hard. Jesus Christ and God the Father know. He is our creator. He has been one of us. We're told in Hebrews 4, remember this, Hebrews 4:16, when we're having trials and difficulties, do we just whimper out a little prayer, you know, oh, please help me? No, it says we can come boldly before the throne of grace, and we shout out to God, and we ask him for help, and we tell him that it hurts, and we're suffering in pain. We come boldly to the throne of grace that we might obtain mercy, and he'll listen. He's there. We'll find grace to help in time of need. Perhaps on a more personal note, on coping with trials and difficulties, We have one another, don't we? We are a family. It's a large family here. This is kind of what it was like back in the 80s. You'd have congregations of 200 people back then. Now, our congregation of 50 is considered a large church. So, but we have one another, and we depend on one another. Our communication with one another is so easy these days. Just pick out your phone and send a text message and a smiley face and say, have a good day, or the old-fashioned way, email. Talk about really old-fashioned ways. There used to be this thing where you could pick up this thing, a receiver, you dial the number, you say hello, and you could actually talk on the phone to people, and they'd hear your voice. But that's kind of outdated now, but you get it. Okay, thank you. Yeah. But anyway, the point is we actually are in touch with one another, and that's important. When one of us is going through a difficult trial, share the trial. In fact, someone did that with me just the other day. That meant so much to me. It was on FaceTime Messenger, actually, and someone said, I've got a very serious situation coming up. I'd like for you to pray about it. That means a lot when someone does that to you, doesn't it? That's a friend who says, I know I can count on you. And we're there for one another. And this did turn out well, by the way. So we reach out to one another for help and support. We're told that should be there. And we're, of course, told in James 2 to do good works for one another, right? James 2, if you see a brother destitute and without, you don't just say, yeah, go off, be fed, be warm, you'll be fine, go on. And we don't do anything? What profit is that, it says? Faith by itself, if it does not have works, is dead. And so we do things. These are the things that we depend on when we're going through a trial, a problem, something like that. We help and we serve one another. I know you've heard that. I know you've been asked to do that. I'm sure you do. So it's clear God is asking something of those of us who He has called to be His first fruits. We're talking about these things as responsibilities that we have as first fruits. It's far more than just being first. Oh, what a treat it is to be first, to be the first ones into the kingdom of God and experience all that power and glory. And wow, that's great. Well, yes, it is. But there's something required for that position, for being a first fruits. Remember what it says in Luke 12:48. This one gets me sometimes. Luke 12:48, to whom is much is given, much has been required. How much have we been given? For us to count our blessings, wow, how many pieces of paper do we need? So much. To whom much has been committed, of him they will ask the more. So much has been given to us and committed to us. And God's looking for something back. What are we going to do back? What's our responsibility? We've got to continue to realize that we are here for a reason. Mr. Armstrong used to use the term that we're in school, in training for the kingdom of God. Our training and preparation covers many aspects of our lives. All of our lives are about that. We're preparing for something, and God knows that. We've seen that our lives are to be, of course, holy, righteous lives. We are to be Christ-like, filled with the characteristics of God's Holy Spirit, being holy in conduct. That's it. That's our responsibility. That's the responsibility of the first fruits. In addition to this, we've got to require knowledge. We study our Bible. We have Bible studies part of our daily routine. We're rooted and established in the doctrines. We're told to hold fast to what we've been taught, that we be careful, not let it slip, not be lured into deception by the tricks of the devil. So we have to be solid in our foundation of what we believe, what we've been taught. God expects us to know our Bible and to live it, be able to explain and teach our beliefs to others who would ask us. We're told that we have to be ready to give an answer. In fact, we were talking a little bit about that in our conversation earlier. Be ready to give an answer for what we believe and why we believe what we believe. All right, those pretty much, I think we have a good understanding of our responsibility as first fruits. Again, far more than just enjoying one another's company, having a church to attend. That's nice. You got to realize some people don't have a congregation to attend. They attend by watching the webcast, and that's a nice opportunity to have that, a nice blessing for people who can't. But it sure is nice to be able to come to a congregation of God's people. We are part of a great work. We have personal work. We have accomplishments to do to accomplish along the way. So again, this is our focus. This is our purpose in life. That's what we're doing right now. This is what God has given us as first fruits. So I want to take a moment now and just kind of step back and think, and as we reflect on what we've covered, look at everything that we've covered from a bit larger perspective now. How does our training and preparation as the first fruits, what we've just discussed, how does that really fit into the overall, the big scheme, the overall plan of God that He has, when we consider the entire plan of God? Again, as Pentecost reminds us of the first fruits, Feast of Tabernacles reminding us that, well, then there must be second fruits, and we can think about what's going to happen in the world tomorrow, the millennial thousand-year reign of Christ. Now, again, we don't use that term, second fruits, but we are, in fact, preparing to be instrumental in the lives of people that God is going to call when the time of the preparation of the first fruits is over. So you think of, you know, the Feast of Trumpets and our resurrection to eternal life, the binding of Satan, the beginning of the millennial rule of Jesus Christ. The time of the second fruits begins then, at that time, after the resurrection or change to immortality of the first fruits. And now the reign of Jesus Christ is going to be established, and His rule begins in Jerusalem. What will those people who are living then, and there of course will be humanity living, what will their world be like in the first few days? Have you ever thought about that? Let's try to go there. During the opening hours and days of, we call it the world tomorrow after Christ returns, that millennial reign, think of those first days, first hours. Millions of people will be in fear and despair, hopelessness. I suspect many of the survivors, even at that time, will believe that their death is imminent because they have seen so much. They have survived so far. But what's just happened in Jerusalem? Your teens are going to be having your teen Bible study about Revelation. So you know the fifth seal and the sixth and what's going to happen. There's been a devastating earthquake like nothing ever experienced before. They will have survived the giant hailstones. There's no fresh water. It's all bitter. Nothing green. I believe we see that in these first few minutes and hours after Christ's dramatic return, the people will be stunned. They will be afraid, hopeless and in despair, confused, wondering, worried. What has happened? What's going to happen next? Again, try to imagine the conditions in various places around the world. Think of a place. What will it be like there? Much of the world, I believe, will be devoid of population because of what has happened. How many people will be alive here in our country, in England, in Australia? Come with me to Leviticus 26. I think at times we need to be reminded of the prophecies concerning the future of the Israelitish nations. They're still here, these prophecies. Yes, it hasn't come to pass, and yes, it's been a lot longer. We thought some of these were going to take place 40, 50 years ago. And it didn't. God had His reasons. And most of us now are kind of glad that, you know, Christ didn't return back in 1975 or whatever. You wouldn't have been born. But still, these prophecies are there. The time is coming, and we're that much closer. Leviticus 26, verse 32. I will bring the land to desolation, and your enemies who dwell in it shall be astonished at it. And I will scatter you among the nations and draw out a sword after you, and your land shall be desolate, your cities laid waste. And the land shall enjoy its Sabbath as long as it lies desolate, and you are in your enemy's land, and the land shall rest and enjoy its Sabbaths. As long as it lies desolate, it shall rest, for the time it did not rest on your Sabbath that you dwelt in it. Let's turn over to Zechariah, or I'll just read it while you're on your way there. You can catch up with me. Zechariah 7 and verse 11. Again, prophecies of the future. A really difficult time that's coming on this world. But why? But they refused to heed. They shrugged their shoulders and stopped their ears so that they could not hear. They made their hearts like flint, refusing to hear the law and the words of the Lord of hosts had sent by his Spirit through the former prophets. So great wrath came from the Lord of hosts. And therefore it has happened, just as he proclaimed, yet they would not hear. And so they called out, and I would not listen, says the Lord of hosts. So I scattered them with a whirlwind among all the nations which they had not known. Thus the land became desolate after them, so that no one passed through or returned. For they made the pleasant land desolate. I think it's not hard to imagine what that's talking about, where that might be. We'll finish in Ezekiel 5, the prophecy of thirds. Ezekiel 5 and verse 12, we're reminded there, one third of you shall die in the pestilence, be consumed with famine in your midst, the third shall fall by the sword all around you. I will scatter yet another third to all the winds and draw out a sword after them. That's what's ahead. We don't like to think about it. We don't like to talk about it. Many will perish, but many will not. What if only 10% of the world's population were to survive? That's still 760 million people alive. That's still a lot. Compare that with the 8 who survived the flood. Let's go to Jeremiah. We've set the stage. This is what's happened. This is what the people are facing, what they have survived. What is their hope? What's the hope now of these people who have survived the great tribulation, the day of the Lord, in regards to God's plan of salvation? Do they yet know God's plan of salvation? It's going to be open to them. They're in for a surprise. Jeremiah 31, verse 7. For thus says the Lord, sing with gladness for Jacob, and shout among the chief of the nations. Proclaim and give praise and say, O Lord, save your people. Why are they calling out that? Save us. They're still thinking they're about to die. Save this remnant of Israel. But behold, I will bring them from the north country and gather them from the ends of the earth, among them the blind and the lame, the woman with child, the one who labors with child. I'll bring them all together. A great throng shall return there, and they will come with weeping and with supplications, and I will lead them. Remember, like a lamb, like a shepherd leads with a lamb? I will lead them, and I will cause them to walk by rivers of water, a straight way in which they shall not stumble. For I am a father to Israel, Ephraim, my firstborn. Hear the words of the Lord, O nations. Declare it in the isles afar off and say, he who scattered Israel will gather him and keep him as a shepherd does his flock. For the Lord has redeemed Jacob and ransomed him from the hand of one who was stronger than he. And therefore they shall come and sing in the heights of Zion, streaming to the goodness of the Lord, for wheat and new wine and oil, for the young of the flock and the herd, and their souls shall be like a well-watered garden, and they shall sorrow no more at all. What wonderful, encouraging verses for these people. You see what's happening? They're being called. Their eyes are being opened. These people are the ones who will be given opportunity to be part of the second fruits. Verse 31. Behold, the days are coming, says the Lord. I will make a new covenant with the house of Israel and the house of Judah. Verse 33. This is a covenant that I will make with the house of Israel after those days, says the Lord. I will put my law in their minds and write it on their hearts. That's happening to us today. It's their turn. And I will be their God. They shall be my people. And no more shall every man teach his neighbor and every man his brother, saying, know the Lord. For they shall all know me, from the least of them to the greatest of them, says the Lord. For I will forgive their iniquity, and their sin I will remember no more. These people are being converted. An incredible message of hope. They needed this message because these survivors will have been through a period of total despair, total hopelessness. They didn't expect this outcome. The only message of hope that they have been hearing, possibly, and I think they likely will have been hearing it, through this time that they've been through, this last 3.5 year period of total despair and hopelessness, the only message of hope that they've been hearing during this period of time has been the good news of the coming kingdom of God, proclaimed from Jerusalem by two men who called themselves the two witnesses. And most of the people have been ignoring their message, thinking that's just a couple of crackpots in Jerusalem. Who are these people? How do they get away with that? Why can't they be stopped? After all, they're causing all the problems the world is going through. It's these two men, it's their fault. And then they've just been through celebrating their death that just occurred a few days ago. Remember? Rejoicing in the streets, and they were giving gifts to one another. Those two men are dead. But how things have changed in just a few days. Their attitude is going to dramatically change as many comprehend what is beginning to happen in Jerusalem. Ezekiel 26. Let's read a few verses here in Ezekiel 26, beginning in verse 23. Again, we're describing the time of the second fruits. These first days and hours and days after the return of Jesus Christ, what things will be like. Their calling, we might say. This is describing their calling. Ezekiel 26, verse 23, I will sanctify my great name, which has been profaned among the nations. Is that not an understatement? Has God's name been profaned among the nations today? Which you have profaned in their midst. And the nations then will know that I am the Lord, says the Lord God, when I am hallowed in you before their eyes. For I will take you from among the nations, and I will gather you out of all the countries to bring you into your own land. We read about that earlier. And I will sprinkle clean water on you. Again, this is conversion we're talking about. And you shall be clean, and I will cleanse you from all your filthiness and from all your idolatry. And I will give you a new heart, and a new spirit within you. And I will take that heart of stone out of your flesh, and I'll give you a heart of flesh. And I will put my spirit within you, second fruits, and cause you to walk in my statutes, and keep my judgments, and you will do them. And you shall dwell in the land that I've given to your fathers. You shall be my people. I will be your God. And verse 31, and then you will remember your evil ways and your deeds, which were not good, and you will loathe yourselves in your own sight for your own iniquities and for your abominations. What's that talking about? That's repentance. That's repentance right there. The second fruits are going to have to go through the same process of repenting that you and I have had to go through. This has already happened to us. And they're going to need help. What do we need help with as our eyes were being opened? Did not we need counseling? You ask for baptism. You go through baptism counseling, right? Part of our responsibility as the first fruits then will be to teach and to prepare them. An incredible blessing for these people to understand how their world has changed and what caused their world to be so evil and so ignorant of God's way of life. Their adversary that they did not recognize, Satan the devil, is now bound and put away for the next 1,000 years. So at least that part of previous evil influences their lives is over. But this first generation of survivors, again, let's put ourselves into their shoes. These men and women and children who live into the beginning days of the world tomorrow will face yet more unique and difficult trials. What trials will the second fruits face? Again, for those who survive, we talked about comfort. They will need someone who understands what hard trials are like. I wonder who that could be. We will be the ones who go to these people and say, I understand how you feel. I know what it's like. I'm here to help you. It's going to be okay. Yes, we'll be spirit beings, but we can manifest ourselves as just a normal human being to them. But I think they'll need something else besides the influence of a spirit being. I believe they'll need literally the guidance, support, and love of fellow human beings. Human beings, young people now who live over into that age, I believe you will be an example for them, a role model for them. You ever wonder how many people that might be who are the children, our children, who live into that age as physical human beings? What number is that? I wonder what it is. People who are in the church or children of church members, they've just spent the last 3.5 years in a place of safety. They've witnessed the return of Jesus Christ. They've witnessed the change of their parents and grandparents, possibly into God beings. But they're younger now. They're not baptized yet. And they're living now physically into this new world that I thought my children would live into. And now they have children. But someday it's going to happen. Right now, it doesn't appear that there will be very many. A few thousand for the entire world, what will that number be? But I believe you will be in huge demand and very popular as you assume leadership roles as role models and advisors, pioneers in a new world. Zechariah 8 and verse 23, I think, refers to you who may live into that world. Zechariah 8:23, I'll just read it. Thus says the Lord of hosts, in those days 10 men from every language of the nation shall grasp the sleeve of a Jewish man. Why did they use the word Jewish? Well, let's use a Sabbath keeper. Let's use one of God's people. And say, let us go with you, for we have heard God is with you. How will they know that? But again, what will it be like for these and other survivors? We're asking in this sermon about the trials of the second fruits. Let's be a little more specific. What are those trials? We'll look at three. Number one, shock of incredible loss and death of their loved ones. Imagine that. Incredible loss and death of their loved ones, and they'll be in shock. All of us know the pain of losing someone we love, especially when someone that we love dies suddenly and unexpected. It hurts when it's expected. But it hurts more when it just suddenly they're gone. It can be devastating and overwhelming, and it takes a long time to cope with, doesn't it? It hurts. The death of a loved one is something you don't just, quote, get over it, do you? The thoughts are always there. But you begin to cope with it. For these second fruits, most of them will have lost multiple family members and friends. People who were close to them. Not only that, they will have experienced the deaths, perhaps, of entire communities. Cities were wiped out. Yes, of course, it will include people they never knew. But again, the horrible shock of knowing how many of your family and friends have recently died, perhaps in tragic circumstances. And perhaps, as you've survived, maybe you even lost a child. And yet here you are. You're living. You somehow survived, but now you're suffering incredible sadness and despair. Wait a minute. We're talking about the opening days of the world tomorrow. That's a time of joy and happiness and peace and rejoicing and, well, blow the trumpet. It's great. Jesus Christ has returned. He's establishing the government of God on this earth. Yeah, that's all true, but put yourself in place of that survivor. He doesn't know that yet. It's still a mystery to him what's happening. He doesn't know about the plan of salvation yet. Perhaps all along as they witnessed these catastrophic events taking place, they thought, well, this must be the work of the Antichrist that we've been hearing about. Or this is happening all over the world. There are other religions besides Christianity. Muslims believing it's the Mahdi that's causing all of this. And, you know, Muhammad's about to come down and take his place. And who's this guy? Maybe it was some kind of alien invasion after all. You know, there's something to Area 51. Many will be confused over what has happened in these first hours and days, considering what they've been taught all their lives. And things aren't happening like they thought. Many, if not all, will not have believed what was coming out of the mouths of those two witnesses that were proclaiming the truth in Jerusalem. They didn't believe that. And after all, didn't we just have them killed? I saw that. I saw their dead bodies lying in the streets. But they're alive? They couldn't have been right after all, could they? So again, do we begin to get a sense of the immediate trials facing these second fruits? What do they need? Who will help them understand? Who will comfort them? Who has prepared in advance to help the second fruits during this extremely difficult trial that they're experiencing now? Who will be there to help them? You can all raise your hand because it's you. You are. The first fruits will provide for the needs of the second fruits. That's what you're preparing for today as first fruits. When someone loses a loved one in death, what's the most comforting and uplifting knowledge they can receive? Well, again, talk to someone outside the church and someone they love has died. And we preach the funeral. And we talk about a second resurrection. And they begin to understand that their loved one will live again. And that's incredible hope. We can show these people now, these second fruits, that all these people who have recently died will live again 1,000 years from now, yes. But for them, it'll just be an instant. After the time when the world will have been restored and the world will have been prepared for them, they'll be able to live in the most wondrous and glorious environment possible. And they'll be so happy and so thrilled to learn God's way of life. We are the ones learning about that hope today because you know what? We stay one more day after the Feast of Tabernacles and we observe the eighth day and we know what that day means. So we're preparing for that. Again, think about this. The second fruits are going to be dealing with death and destruction on a massive worldwide scale. Unprecedented. The world has never seen anything like it. But who could possibly understand what that's like? A world that's been totally devastated. None of us have ever had to face that, right? None of us have. What about Mr. and Mrs. Noah? Their sons and their wives. Assuming they're in the first resurrection, now immortal God beings, imagine, what if they were to be guest speakers at the International Symposium, attended by thousands and perhaps displayed internationally by some means of communication, video communication that God has that puts this to shame? I believe sometimes we can do a little out-of-the-box thinking about practical ways that God is going to fulfill the needs of the survivors, these second fruits. God is preparing a people today. He has prepared some people who are waiting in their graves for the time of the second fruits. And He's just not preparing us for personal salvation. We have responsibility. He's preparing us to serve other people. We're learning how to do that. The first others we will serve as new members of the family of God, I'm calling them the second fruits. And they have trials. A second trial of the second fruits. Their world has completely changed unexpectedly. We've already touched on that. There was once upon a time a book called Future Shock. Well, these people are going to go through future shock, culture shock. The vast majority of these survivors had no idea 3 or 4 years earlier that anything like this was going to occur. 4 years ago, they were planning a wedding, taking the kids to soccer or football practice, taking classes at a university, farming in a rice paddy. Whatever it was, wherever in the world it was. And then the world that they knew changed, and changed quickly and unexpectedly. Millions were uprooted. Millions were taken to slave labor camps. Others ran those slave labor camps. Almost everyone, it seems, lost their homes, been trying to eke out an existence in some temporary shelter, some in caves, just trying to find enough food and water to somehow keep surviving, because they've been living in a world where it seems it's impossible to live. Back to Revelation chapter 6. This will be their world. Just prior to realizing they are the second fruits. Revelation 6 and verse 12, I looked when he'd opened the sixth seal. Teens, here's the sixth seal. Behold, there was a great earthquake, and the sun became black as sackcloth of hair, and the moon became like blood. And the stars of heaven fell to earth as a fig tree drops its late figs when it's shaken by a mighty wind. And the sky receded as a scroll when it's rolled up, and every mountain and island was moved out of its place. And the kings of the earth, the great men, the rich men, the commanders, the mighty men, every slave and every free man, hid themselves in the caves and in the rocks of the mountains. But they said to the mountains and rocks, "Will fall on us, hide us from the face of him who sits on the throne and from the wrath of the Lamb, for the great day of his wrath has come. And who is able to stand?" And yet somehow, these second fruits did just that. They stood. But everything has changed. People they don't know are coming up to them now, and talking to them and telling them it's going to be okay. And say, telling them that hope is coming, change is coming. The pivotal scripture, remember? Acts 3:19. A world tomorrow scripture. Repent and be converted that your sins may be blotted out, so that the times of refreshing may come from the presence of the Lord. And he will send Jesus Christ that heaven must receive until the time of the restitution of all things. These survivors are beginning to hear about what this new world that they find themselves in, what that new world is going to be like, and they're surprised. They can't believe it. But you see, their world is changing. But let's ask a question. Do you like change? Only when we get it from spending a dollar, right? You know, we like that kind of change. We like things to remain the same as they used to be. We like the way it was when we grew up. And we're resistant to change. Many of us are fearful and apprehensive about change, and our world has changed fast. You think their world will change fast? Everything has changed. I've lost my home, my family, my job, my country. Everything I've ever known and loved is gone. All I've ever believed in has let me down. I wasn't raptured. I didn't get the 70 virgins. I wasn't reincarnated as a cow. Again, we have to keep in mind, these second fruits are going to come from all over the world. And they have been now in a state of helplessness and confusion, and they need help, and they need clarity, and they need someone to explain everything to them. They need to talk to someone who knows what's going on. And that's you. You're preparing to sit down and talk to the second fruits about what it's like to have your whole world come crashing down on you. Because you've experienced it too. You've been there too. You know what it's like. We've had experiences like this. Some of us remember Mr. Armstrong had that happen to him. I want to quote from the autobiography, volume 1, chapter 15. Autobiography of Mr. Herbert Armstrong. He said, quote, "This would mean in another 2 or 3 years an income larger than I had ever before contemplated." He had this opportunity out ahead of him. "I began to see visions of personal net income of $300,000 to $500,000 a year." And that was back in the 20s, right? Imagine that today. But he says, "And then the bottom fell out. It seemed as if some invisible, mysterious hand were causing the earth to simply swallow up whatever business I started, and through no fault or cause of our own making. This was in the autumn of 1926. My business was gone, all but one laundry account in Portland, where we were living at the time. This one advertising account required only about 30 minutes a week of my time. So I had time on my hands for a challenge, and so it was that in the fall of 1926, crushed in spirit, from business reverses not of my making, humiliated by what I regarded as my wife's religious fanaticism, I entered into an in-depth study of the Bible for the first time in my life, into the quote. And aren't we glad he did? But that's the point. He knows what that's like. And others, perhaps, have suffered such crushing blows where it seems as if their whole world came crashing down on them, and they have to start again with nothing. I think that probably happened here in the Houston area with some hurricane that went here a few months ago. Flying over, I kept looking down. I said, well, I'm going to see the damage from the hurricane. I didn't see anything. It's all been restored already, seems, at least what I could see from the air. But these people, at this time, these second fruits will have been humbled, and they're ready to reach out. Somebody take my hand. Somebody help me. Not knowing, not having any idea where that help's going to come from. And there you are. There you are. And you're ready because you've been prepared. What are you going to say to them? They'll need to hear words of comfort, hope, and peace. How about them hearing Isaiah chapter 40 and verse 1? Isaiah 40, verse 1. This is read almost every year at the Feast of Tabernacles. Comfort. Yes, comfort my people, says your God. Speak comfort to Jerusalem. Cry out to her and say, your warfare is ended and your iniquities are pardoned. Imagine them hearing that. What do these people really need? They need full understanding of what's happened. Perhaps this morning there will be some announcement of what's going on. I wonder what that announcement that might be proclaimed from Radio Jerusalem or whatever means of communication we have that morning. How about Isaiah 61 and verse 1? The Spirit of the Lord God is upon me because the Lord has anointed me to preach good tidings to the poor. He has sent me to heal the brokenhearted. There's a lot of brokenhearted people roaming what streets there are left. To proclaim liberty to the captives. Some have been captive for 3 years. The opening of prisons to those who are bound. And they are inspired by hearing that. And you're beginning to reach them. And they're beginning to understand and have hope. But their trials are still continuing. The healing takes time. They're still getting used to this new environment, an environment they never expected, and an understanding of just who is Jesus Christ and what is he doing really in Jerusalem. Put yourself in their place again. Your basic needs are now being met. You've got food, clothing, shelter. You have regular updates. You're getting information about what's going on. You know a little bit about the plan, what's going to happen next week. You at least now have the assurance that you will live to see another day. And then, that starts to hurt too. Trial number 3. Survivor guilt. Survivor guilt. Why did I survive and so many of my friends and family did not? This is a real phenomenon. I want to quote from goodtherapy.org. There's an article there entitled Survivor Guilt, and it states, quote, symptoms of survivor guilt typically include nightmares, difficulty sleeping, flashbacks to the traumatic event, loss of motivation, irritability, a sense of numbness, thoughts about the meaning of life. Individuals who experience survivor guilt may wonder why they lived and other people died. Why did they get so lucky when others did not? Whether they could or should have done something more to prevent the deaths of others, and whether other people suffered during the time of their death. End of quote. Any of you ever have these emotional situations, conditions? Perhaps some of you have. Ever wonder why God has allowed you to experience trauma or severe loss in your life? Ever wonder if you're in the military, why you survived a war while seeing your buddies die, get blown up right before your very eyes, and you lived? Who could help? Perhaps Joshua will have something to say to help the second fruits. Chapter 14 and verse 10. You remember the story of Joshua and the spies? And not very many people were able to enter into the promised land during those 40 years. They died in the desert. But Joshua 14, verse 10, "Behold, the Lord has kept me alive. As he said, these 45 years, ever since the Lord spoke this word to Moses while Israel wandered in the wilderness, and now here I am this day, 85 years old. And yet I am as strong this day as on the day that Moses sent me. Just as my strength was then, so now is my strength for war, or for going out and coming in. Now therefore, give me this mountain of which the Lord spoke in that day. For you have heard in that day how Anakim, or the giant people, were there, and how the cities were great and fortified it. It may be that the Lord will be with me." Joshua has confidence, and he knows what it's like to be the only one of his generation. You see, that's what the second fruits will come to understand. It just may be that the Lord will be with me after all. These people, I don't know who they are. These people are trying to help me. But these people, they're representatives of Jesus Christ and of God. They do understand how I feel. They are going to help me. I do have hope for tomorrow. And so the second fruits now begin their lives as that first pioneer generation of the world tomorrow, the second fruits of God's great harvest. And they will learn the ways of God from the first fruits. And they'll learn to celebrate Pentecost. And they will learn that they soon themselves will inherit the kingdom of God and what that means to them. And they will soon learn that the trials that they've had to endure over these past difficult years, while yes, they've been difficult and hard, those trials will make them uniquely qualified and prepared to teach, to train, and to prepare a new generation yet to come. And perhaps we'll call them the third fruits and beyond. It's been a pleasure to be with you today. Really enjoy being here. It's my first time ever in Houston. I hope it's not my last. Have a good Sabbath.